on Saturday at 12 noon, I had the opportunity to offer the funeral of a 96-year-old longtime neighbor in my neighborhood, Greentree. She and her husband had 5 boys, 9 grandchildren, 14 great-grandchildren. She was one of 9 children. And I said my homily yesterday that her husband and hers marriage was built on Christ's love. And Christ's love for them and for the church, that was the foundation of the generations of love. And all of us have been recipients of that generous love. Love isn't love until you give it away. Grace isn't grace until we realize grace is not for us. It's for others through us. That's divine life. That's God's love. That's agape love. In the Greek, the love as God loves. I asked a patient recently, "Where are you from?" And she said, "My mother's womb." And I thought to myself, she's so correct. The prophet today, Jeremiah, in the first chapter, tells us the seed of the call of discipleship, of our vocation. Before you were born in your mother's womb, I set you apart for a special purpose. To be consecrated for God's purpose. Not our own will, not our own way, not our own image. I have a special mission for each one of you. It's not a sign that you're holy. It's a challenge to become holy. God made each of us for a special mission, a special purpose that he gave to no one else. When God created us and had us in mind, he had specific good works for each of us to do that were well prepared in advance. Nothing is random, nothing is meaningless about our lives. We were created for God's special, sacred purpose. God never gives us a responsibility without first giving us divine assurance. God never calls us without first comforting us. God never appoints us without first anointing us. We must not live in fear, Jeremiah teaches us. We must trust in God's plan. God did not choose Jeremiah to be a prophet because of his outstanding mental acumen. He didn't choose Jeremiah because he had terrific looks or had extraordinary gifts or radiant charisms or a legion of friends. God reached out his hand and touched Jeremiah's mouth to proclaim to the nations God's word, God's prophecies. God put into Jeremiah's mouth and appointed him over nations and kingdoms to uproot and tear down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant. So God's plan isn't about you. It isn't about me. It's about God working through each of us. Every single moment of our life is a sacred opportunity to do good works that God has prepared for us in advance out of love for him. God can use us to bring hope and salvation to people. That's his plan. And if he uses us, it may be no other person in the universe that they ever meet. So decide today, Jeremiah, trust in the Lord. Do God's will. Fulfill his purpose and the mission he's given to you, and you will have an eternal impact on all the world and everything. And when you speak the truth to somebody, it's a dangerous thing because they may think you're crazy. Because it rattles the status quo of complacency, convenience, comfort. Prophets make us feel uncomfortable, even when it's inconvenient. Every century, friends, has had dilemmas, political turmoil, wars, crimes, tragedies. But every century has also had peaceful, faithful, loving people who were deeply immersed in God's love and brought that love to others every day of their lives. You know them, I know them. Jesus now goes to his own hometown of Nazareth. What happens? All hell breaks out. He's not afraid to ruffle feathers in the least, is he? Jesus upsets the apple cart of the people who think they have him figured out. He's the Messiah. Oh, he's just Joseph's son. He's just a carpenter. No special credentials. But he tells them about his mission, that his love is a universal love. It excludes no one, it includes everyone. It's a love for even the Gentiles, the outsiders. That nobody has a bat or a monopoly or privy to God's love. God's love is endless. God works outside of our predetermined mindsets or ideas. As the Venerable Fulton Sheen says in his beautiful book, one of the greatest books I've ever read in my life, The Power of Love, Venerable Fulton Sheen says, when you love, everything is easy. When you don't love, everything is difficult. Love is the key to revealing Christianity to the world. When we fail in love, we fail in Christianity. Jesus uses the example of the widow of Zarephath and Naaman the Syrian, who were both Gentiles. God's prophets went to them, Elijah and Elisha, and God's miracles took place. Israel, on the other hand, kept turning their back on God's messengers. So Jesus comes. He's the fulfillment of the law and all the prophets. And he testifies. But what happened? They reject him. They even reject him more than the previous prophets that he sent. God's plan of salvation is made present in Jesus, his son. So in going back to his own hometown, his approval rating quickly wanes. The townspeople, in a matter of seconds, move from praise and admiration to doubt and suspicion. Rage and fury, and the fury is so intense that they want to hurl Jesus down the hill headfirst. Let that sink in for a while. Church first. Church folks try to assassinate Jesus on his first day of public ministry. Jesus preached the truth of God's love. He threatened the powers to be. Guess what? The synagogue couldn't ignore it. He rocked their world, and he rocks our world as well. Jesus has a universal vision. It includes and never excludes. Jesus calls us to break down barriers, boundaries, to take his message of salvation to every person that we meet every day. And as Mother Teresa would say, the next person you meet, you must prove God's love by manifesting it. God's love comes in unexpected places, in unexpected people, on unexpected days, in unexpected ways. And we all know it. one of us has been baptized and immersed in the greatest love of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, and He's created. Give us the power to love. But we know through life is not always loving. People are not always loving. But love never changes. Love is unwavering. Love is resilient. Even though, like Jeremiah and Jesus, we go through trials, we go through disappointments, we go through misunderstandings, we go through failures, we go through rejections. Yet God, through His Holy Spirit, continues to purify us, doesn't He? He humbles us. In the ups and downs of our journey of life, He cleanses us. He heals us. He forgives us. And He loves us relentlessly. Servant of God, Dorothy Day said, I only really know God as much as the person I least love in the world. I only know God to the degree of the least person in the world that I fail to love. When you're in the presence of love, you know it. When there's the absence of love, you feel it. St. Paul, of all the epistles in the New Testament, he speaks eloquently and personally to each one of us today. The greatest gift from Bethlehem to Calvary is love. Love is the work of a lifetime. Love is the mission of Jesus. Love is the key to every day and the promise. When we receive the gift of God's graces that we have been given, they are not for us. But through us, they feel and experience God's magnificent love. Yesterday, going back to my hometown where I grew up as a boy, with all my friends and neighbors, and all the years and decades that passed, I felt loved there. Why? Because no matter what playing field we were on, public school, Catholic school, private school, more or less, God had a mission and a sacred purpose for each one of our lives. That mission is to share